So now that we've reviewed concepts like motion and energy and momentum, we'll extend that to a new situation where we're no longer going to just consider chunks of solid that all moves together, but we're moving into this idea of the movement of fluids. The complication of fluid is, as opposed to solid, is different parts of the fluid, it's really easy for them to move past one another. So it's no longer just a consideration of one single solid block of stuff all moving in the same spot. Rather, we have to cut up this single chunk of block of stuff, and every single little block, arbitrarily small down to maybe the size of a molecule, each chunk is kind of doing its own thing. So here's a situation where in physics we start considering the most simplest of system, one single chunk, and then extend that idea to a more complicated situation, and our model for it has to also become more complicated as a result to properly describe the behavior of these things. So going down this path, because we're slicing anything we're considering up into many small chunks, we no longer deal with mass. So our mass, we have to divide by the volume, which give us rho, which is density. And then the forces that you apply, it's going to be divided by your area. And this is what we call pressure. Turns out that in considering the motion of small chunk of the bigger whole, it's a lot more useful to think in terms of density and pressure rather than mass and forces. So this question really quickly just gets you used to the idea of pressure and relating it to forces, because hopefully you're familiar with the idea of density already. So we're talking about an eyeball. Excuse my very poor drawing of the eyeball, but here is kind of your cornea. And inside the eyeball, it's filled with liquid, right? It's kind of like a balloon almost, more like a water balloon. And there's so much liquid on the inside that it likes to stretch out and push outwards on your eyeball. Of course, your eyeball keeps it in, right? Just like a water balloon. And you can measure that pressure by measuring the amount of force over a certain amount of area. So there's a certain amount of force on this area, you get the pressure. So that's all it really is. Pressure is force over area. We're given the force and we're given the area, but let's change this into meter square to get our proper SI unit. And to convert that, you need to do this conversion twice because it's centimeter square into meter square. The centimeter square cancels out that centimeter square. And as long as you apply the 100 twice, you will get the correct number, newtons per meter square. And this here, we define as a pascal with a symbol PA. That's the SI unit that we define for pressure. But they don't want it in pascal, they want it in this millimeter mercury thing. And the conversion factor here, which by the way, the printed textbook version has a typo. So the correct number here is 133.39. So in whatever unit this is, it's based on how we used to construct pressure measurement device, but it's 20 of that unit. In the next couple questions, we'll look a little more closely into a little bit of the direction, quote unquote, of pressure and how that works. But in terms of the value, it's just F over A.